So I thought we could go to the Book of John. I've been missing. I was MIA last week if you guys were here. But I would try my hand and try to be like Paul and do some like work, some construction. But I'm not. So I'm here. But it was fun. We were building, fixing up a shop. And I know a lot of you guys came and got to have fun here. But I missed you guys. So I've been reading in the Book of John, and the reality is that I woke up this morning, and I had not a clue what I wanted to share or what the Lord wanted to share, honestly, tonight. And then I just began to get back to where I was at personally, and where I had been reading was in John chapter 8, or I had finished chapter 7 and was headed into chapter 8. And so I was reading it, and just kind of between me and the Lord, and then just kind of let it roll around, and essentially I just really felt it pressed upon my heart that that was exactly what the Lord wanted to just kind of for us to just go through tonight and consider it. And as that kind of unraveled throughout the day, one of the things that was really cool was that I was just able to spend time, one, just hanging out with the family and kind of mulling it over. And then when I got away and just really started praying about tonight, I felt like the Lord was just like pressing heavily upon me the fact that we have an amazing, loving Father. Like, you know, the reality that we, and for me, like just thinking about who I am and thinking about who that I was before I came to know Jesus, the reality is that the Lord saw me in all my horrific condition and still had grace enough to want to save me and want to bring me into his household and call me his. And it just kind of was overwhelming, honestly. Like, as I just felt literally like amazingly blessed sitting back praying. And it made me remember, like, at Christmas time, there's a lot of really well-meaning and I think awesome, not bad at all, just good. It's like the Christian cliche kind of thing of like, let's talk about Christmas being the time that Jesus was born in the manger. And there's a lot of really cool things you can go and look at the manger scene and you can take away from it. But the Lord, I think, for what he was pressing on me was the reality of like the facts, simple things about Jesus. Why was he born in a manger? I mean, we know that Jesus was absolutely like everything about who he is and how he came. Was something that the Lord had predestined, preordained. It wasn't by chance. But as I was reading, and we'll see here in a little bit tonight, that just Jesus was not accepted by the world just flat out. And it was only by the revelation of the Holy Spirit that the Father would like give, essentially open up those token Jews while Jesus was actively ministering. And then later, when the Holy Spirit came upon the disciples and they went out and preached, the Holy Spirit would open up the eyes and soften the hearts of people. But no one came to Jesus really like knowing, oh, this is the Messiah. There was a resistance. And so essentially, like, as you read through the stories like we're going to see tonight, it's pretty brutal when you think, if we were to really like think, let's go back in time to the time of Jesus, the time of Christ. And we would have probably thought, as a Jew, that the Pharisees and the Sadducees being kind of the cream of the crop, we would have looked to them for wisdom, for sure, without a doubt, we would have, or at least knowledge of the scriptures. And it's pretty sad when those that were standing out front, so to speak, representing the only one true God, are the ones that Jesus comes into the most like battle, like head-to-head, obvious, like, true, just, wow, someone's dying, I'm serious. But, I mean, he calls them some horrible names. He calls them brood of vipers. He calls them whitewashed tombs, sepulchers. He calls them dead men's bones. Like, what Jesus says about these people that we would have thought, man, they're great, at first read for me, after I first got saved, I just started thinking, wow, Pharisees and Sadducees, they're such hypocrites and idiots. I never want to be like them. But the older I get as a Christian, the more I'm like, oh man, Lord, help me to not be like that. Not because it's so far from me, but because it's so close to where I could easily be. Mm-hmm. And that's convicting. And when I read through the word, I realize, and recently the Lord has been gracious and he's brought people to me in just the past few weeks that I know, but they're not from the church. They're not. They're people that I've been around over the years, and just for whatever reason, the Lord has allowed me to be a light, to reflect Christ in their lives. And I had a couple of them just in the last 2 weeks, like I said, but I had a good friend of mine come, and we got to hang out and talk, and some truth, I was sharing the truth of Jesus and truth of what it is to walk with him, and I was brought to this heavy duty reality that oftentimes we are more happy just to take this word that we have as just being kind of like a religion or even like a set of guidelines to live our lives by, but we don't realize that there's some pretty significant things that should make us never handle it like that. Like we should in a sense pray that never happens, that we just look at the Bible as rules and regulations, laws, and standards, but in fact what it is. And so before we even read in the chapter, I want to pray again, and I want to read a few verses leading up to John chapter 8 that essentially the Lord hammered into my heart in a good way this morning or this afternoon. But it takes faith. There's nothing about being a Christian that you can learn in your head. It takes faith. It takes the Holy Spirit revealing it to you, and it takes him working in you. And it's something we can request of him. It's something that we can petition him for, and it's something that we seek after. And so aligning back to kind of why I even talked about Jesus in the manger is that Jesus, essentially, he's coming, he's standing. I love that he says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and I'll come into any man that will let me in." And I believe that for us, we need to approach this season that is probably not even close to the actual time Jesus was born, but that's totally irrelevant. We celebrate it as believers and draw our attention, hopefully, back to that unto us a king is born, that we're worshiping our king. And we celebrate his birth, and we gather under an evergreen tree because we know that his love never fails. We know that he's unending. So it's a beautiful thing, but the big thing is it's only by faith. None of that stuff is any good if it's just in the flesh. And so let's pray, and then I want to just share some cool stuff. Father, help us tonight, Lord. Thank you for my brothers and sisters that we get to be together. It's just so good. I see how your word is so true. It's so good for the brethren to dwell together, Lord, and just to have that unity. And we're aware, Lord, that you are so far greater than us, and your ways are so much higher. Your thoughts are so much better. And that's so good and such a relief, Lord, because we are in such a desperate need for your every hour, every moment, touch and wisdom. And Lord, we just hunger for you, for your love, for your spirit to move in our lives. And tonight I just ask for myself and for my brothers and sisters in this room, Lord, that you would give us eyes to see what your word, one, Lord, would speak into us, that what your spirit is saying. Help us to understand tonight, even just to a greater degree, or be reminded of the truth we already maybe know of who you are and what an amazing thing that it is to be in you, and the treasures that are found in you, that they trump everything on earth. That, Lord, you are all that we will ever need. And help us tonight to see you clearer. Help us to understand what it is to be in your presence, to seek your will in our lives. And so I pray your word tonight would go out, that it would do exactly your will in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. So I really just wanted to read a verse. You don't have to turn there. And probably most people know this verse by heart, but I can't remember anything. It's one of the tragedies of misused youth. There you go. See, exactly. Broken brain. But it says in Genesis 1:1, "In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good." That's all I wanted to read there. And then I wanted to just turn really quick, which you don't need to turn there, to John. And this is one of the John chapter 1, verse 1. It says this. It says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And so I know that even like, I think it was last night and this morning, Brett referenced in his, what he was sharing with all of us, just that truth that Jesus is the Word made flesh. And so the thing about all this, why am I talking about this? And we're going to get into this chapter. And this chapter talks about Jesus proclaiming that he's the light of the world and that he is the only truth. And this is the thing that the Spirit like put so much on my heart today, is that it's important for us to realize that that statement in Genesis 1:1 is almost impossible for every person to hear apart from those of us that have been called, apart from those of us that should have the understanding that we have been blessed with a gift. Being able to understand and have faith to see the Lord as being who he really is, to see God's word as really being from God, that's not of man. That's not something that we can learn in our flesh. It's spiritual. So the reality is how can you and I try to serve the God of the Spirit when we're most oftentimes doing it in our flesh? And that's where I believe that the real like mystery lies, is that Jesus comes on the scene and he begins to do the will of the Father without exception. Everything he does is the will of the Father. And he walks 100% by the Spirit, but he's doing it physically. And then he preaches and preaches and preaches, and everything he preaches is beyond the understanding of those people, the religious people, and most people. Why? Because they're so conditioned to live in the flesh. Even the people that were so-called spiritual were living in a physical, earthly manner. And the way that the priests would make sacrifice, everything had become a religious duty. And it basically had gone from a relationship in which it was always intended to be, had gone to a place of where it was just part of what you do as a Jew, part of what you do if you're of this house or that house. And it's like, the reality is that I think that the church, the bride, us that are here in this room and all over the face of the earth, that it's important for us to not lose sight that when you read a statement like Genesis 1:1, that's humongous. Because every time that you come in contact with someone who doesn't know this God that you and I live our lives unto, that statement is not true. So everything else is then brought under slavery to the what? The ruler of this world. And the ruler currently of this world until Jesus returns is none other than Satan. And so when we try to link up with the household of Satan, and then we're of the household of God, and we try to operate at the same standard, we're totally fooling ourselves and deceiving ourselves. And then when we run into issues like what my dear friend was just sharing truth with me late night here, like, I love it, the Lord does that, but we were going round and round and round, and it was like I could talk and talk and talk, and then all of a sudden I just sat there, and it was like, and this is the thing, is that this brother has come to know Christ, so it's like over time, I know that this person knows Jesus, and I, like all of a sudden the light came on. Diversion, like you had been walking with Jesus, spiritually living in the Spirit, and then all of a sudden something happened where you just started living for Jesus in the flesh, and you no longer look at this as being something that's spiritual, and you start rationalizing everything, even why you sin, when you sin, and what sort of temptations await you around different turns, so maybe don't go do them, and you start to try to build all these religious like little boundaries for yourself, and no longer is God even in that. He's not even with you, because you don't need him. You've built your own little system. And so it's interesting how that you build your system and then your system fails. It collapses because the Lord won't honor that, because it's a relationship. And then there's all these questions of why is this failing all around me? And it's, you have to go back. You go, well, I don't know. And then it's why? Because it's spiritual, because you forgot even the very truth that the light has come. Jesus Christ is the light of the world. If we no longer are walking in the light as he is in the light, but yet we say we're in the truth, we're what? We're a liar. And so it's a real person we're walking with. It's not a knowledge. It's not that the people that would have heard Jesus preaching and teaching and going from city to city, that they witnessed the light and therefore carried it and never were in the darkness again, but that they saw a great light. But the invitation is beyond the seeing of the great light. It's the being in the light with him. And the reality is that when we're in the light, we're clean, right? The light exposes all of our sins, but the Lord's already paid for all of the sins. So when we're in the presence of Christ, there begins to be that new man, that new woman that starts to hunger and thirst after righteousness because he is righteous. Because being in the presence of the Lord, we receive that fullness. And so the reality is that the Lord was like pressing that on me because it's easy for us to talk about stories that are awesome and cool about Jesus and the virgin birth, and that's super miraculous, but those are just seeing flashes of light. The light. But it's so much more important for us to ask the question and pray about that and live in the place of, well, Lord, what have I prepared for you? You know, Joseph and Mary, they went to the inn and there was no place. There was no preparation for the Messiah. So they moved along. And I would say, well, what kind of preparation have I made for God's word in my life? Like, where am I at? When I read the word, does the word convict me? Because it should, because I'm a sinner. Like, if I read the word and there's no conviction, then I would say that I'm probably not actually allowing it to go into me. So when there is conviction, the beauty is, we're not going to go through the story tonight. I honestly was hoping that after the new year, we could do communion and probably go through talking about this, the first chunk here in chapter 8, which is the woman that was caught in adultery. But essentially, when you go, okay, Lord, like, there's conviction here, it should cause in us the thing that it does with this lady, which we'll get to, is that, see, all the other guys that were there in the story that came with accusations, Jesus writes on the ground. We don't know what he writes, but we know that whatever he writes in his posture, he's hunched down and he's writing. And then he's as he writes and he stands up and he makes a statement to the men that are there with stones ready to stone her, which would have been their right according to the law, that Jesus is like, well, let the one of you that is without sin throw the first stone. Boom, kneels back down, starts writing. The light is shown. What are you going to do in the light? And what's he writing? I could imagine that he is probably not exposing. I've heard so many different things that he's writing the person's name down. I actually, the more that I study it, the more I believe that he's writing all of the sins of the woman down, but not in who with who, but the dates of all of her sin, bringing it out. Like us, when we come to Christ, like, there's no denying that he's wanting us to be honest with him and confess our sins. So we come out, and at first we're like, I'm done, I'm dead. And all of those things are brought out before him. He's letting it be known. I know all of your sins. I have them all here. I think potentially what happened is those were being listed out. Maybe those dates and times, or if it was that, maybe those were those guys in that circle, that they were there that night. I was there in that afternoon, and the older ones left first, potentially going, oh man, anybody that knows that type of stuff, I'm not messing with it, and they leave. But the reality is that when they all, in that conviction, they run away from Jesus. They go away from him because they don't like what he has to show with the light. As he, boom, here it is, they go away. The woman stays after they all stay. And that's the reality. It's that the conviction that the Lord, that the Holy Spirit, not condemnation. Paul tells us there's no condemnation when you're in Christ. It's not that we feel this heaviness and that we're condemned, that, oh man, this is who I am, I'll never change, there's no way out, I've been an adulterer, I've been selling my body, and that's not what's happening. It's a conviction. It's something inside of us that's pitting us to turn to the one, the lover, the one that can forgive us, that can wash us and cleanse us. So the woman stands before Jesus in the light, and he doesn't accuse her. He knows everything, but he doesn't hold it against her. Instead, he gives her one thing. He says, go and sin no more. And he gives an opportunity for her to go out with a free, clean slate, to be with him in the light. So the story that we're going to read through tonight, just as much as we can, because I know that, like, if kids start dying, we'll just call it a night, and that's all good. My hope is this, and I just want you guys to join with me. Here's the deal. I just want to be with Jesus. Like, I just want my life to be in Christ. I'm prone to wander and to look into what the world has to offer. But I'm gonna be honest, I hate that about myself. But I'm aware of it, and I'm not gonna deny it. But as I read through the Word and I see who Jesus is, I go, man, I just want to be with Him. I just want to stay in the light. And my hope is that that's what we would all walk away from tonight. That whatever you take away from this, that it would just encourage you that Jesus, He really is the light. And when we find ourselves in a place that we don't want to be in the light, it's a dangerous place. And it needs to be dealt with. We don't want to blow that off. We don't want to distance ourselves and be removed. And this is one of those chapters that I think that you see the perfect balance of God's love and God's righteousness. That He's not willing. His love is so powerful and so right and perfect that He's not willing to dumb it down. He's not going to tell you what you want to hear. He's going to speak truth. And that very truth we'll find here in this chapter is designed in such a way that if we listen and allow it to penetrate our hearts, that it will set us free. All whatever we're in bondage to, whatever we've been chained up in, that the truth of who Jesus is, what His Word is, that it's living, the very thing that formed the earth that we're on and the stars in the sky was made by Him, then we realize, as much as I don't like this, it's the truth and I want to walk in that. And that's the thing. You think that the woman caught in adultery liked that she was caught in adultery? No, but I bet if you caught up with her later, that was the greatest day of her life. And that's the same thing. When I gave my life to Christ, it was the most horrific, horrifying thing. I had to deal with all the sin that I'd ever done. Heaviest, worst place I've ever been. Greatest day of my life. So I just want to pick it up in John chapter 8, verse 12, since you guys are all pre there. That's creased into your Bible, I'm sure. So right immediately after the woman there caught in adultery, it says in verse 12, it says again, Jesus spoke to them saying, what? He says, I'm the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So the Pharisee said to him, and this is what's crazy, I just real quick, because I don't want to just go bop, 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 verse by verse and just hammer out all this, but Jesus has been going from city to city, and essentially all that He's doing is speaking truth and setting people free, healing sick, forgiving sins. And these people, the Pharisees, don't like it. It's that simple. It doesn't take like this, well, I wonder why. They just don't like it. There's a lot of reasons why it would have affected what their ministry was or their job, but let's just read through. So He speaks these words that you and I, we have seen. We know Jesus is our Lord, He's our Savior, and hopefully that's true in our lives, and we're walking in that, but we know that this Jesus is God in the flesh. These guys are still testing that and not believing it. So in verse 13, it says here, so the Pharisee said to Him, you're bearing witness about yourself. Your testimony is not true. Jesus answered, if I do bear witness about myself, my testimony is true, for I know where I come from and where I'm going. But you do not know where I come from or where I'm going. You judge according to the flesh. I judge no one. Yet even if I do judge, my judgment is true. For it is not I alone who judge, but I and the Father who sent me. In your law it is written that the testimony of two people is true, and I am the one who bears witness about myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness about me. They said to Him, therefore, where is your Father? And Jesus answered, you know neither me nor my Father. If you knew me, you would know my Father also. These words He spoke in the treasury as He taught in the temple, but no one arrested Him because his hour had not yet come. So some pretty cool things. And I don't know, honestly, today I feel like the Lord like opened my eyes major, like massively to this scripture in ways I'd never understood it. It's like, because He makes this statement And I went to Bible college, and I studied through this, and I tried my best to understand when Jesus is referencing like this witness, and I understand that like that was established in the law, like generally just in judging somebody, that if someone had done something, if there were two witnesses, then they made that was the truth. You bring the two witnesses, they testify that this is what they saw, and that's the truth. But what I never realized about this statement that was so powerful, and I gotta say too, I realized Jesus Christ, Son of God, he's testifying of himself. If you track back to before this happened, there is several times that the Father has testified of him, including one audible one when he was baptized, that the Lord literally spoke out of heaven and said, "This is my Son in whom I'm well pleased." So you know that there's a true testimony, and Jesus is just saying, "This is who I am." The Father in heaven testifies of who I am. But there's all of this prophecy, too, that backs up who he is, even the day that he would have been born. All this stuff that's just, like, so crazy, like, this is who I am. But what I think is even more awesome that the Lord was, like, showing me, it's not better than, but it's just cool, too, is he says, "I'm the light of the world," right? And then they go after him. And what does light do? Like, it radiates. And so there's, when you say you're the light of the world, which only Jesus can be, then we can compare it to the sun. Like the sun in the sky. Like when the sun burns, what does it do? It testifies, "I am the sun." Like you cannot deny it, right? What does the moon do? It reflects what the sun is doing, but it does not declare that "I am the sun." But the reality is that Jesus is literally going, "I'm the light of the world." Now, is it something of pride for him to say who he is? No, he's doing exactly what light does. It radiates. He's just simply, because he is the truth, he simply is saying, "This is who I am." That's not out of any pride or anything. It's just the facts. I'm the light of the world. So when you read that and you see what he's saying to the Pharisees, then he goes on, you go, wow, like, even you can't even really say that Jesus is standing in a posture to these religious leaders and trying to position himself like, "Who are you to talk to me?" We know that Jesus was like the most humble person ever. So I believe that potentially even the way that he responds to them is just simply like they're saying, "Oh, you're the," and he's just, "Well, I testify and it's the truth." And it's irrelevant whether you say it's the truth, because it is who I am. And my Father in heaven testifies of me. And these two here are bearing witness, and therefore it is. What are you going to do about that? What are you going to do about it? Like, more like, now go away and think about that. And so when the fact is that he just states something that is horrible, because he says, "Well, where's your Father?" It goes back to this whole point of kind of what the Lord was showing me, what I'm trying to share tonight is religion. Because they come to him and then they speak to him about spiritual things. "Well, you're not." But then he says, "Well, I am." And then they go, "Well, where's your Father?" Well, they should know, right, who he says that his Father is? Father is in heaven. It's God. But they're going to go back to carnality, back to the flesh. And why is it important? Because I think that this is exactly why I don't, maybe you're not, maybe you guys don't struggle with this, but I'm in the flesh. Like, so there's days that are awesome where automatic first thing that I'm thinking is the spiritual truth of what's happening in situations. But then there's other times where I go, "Well, where's your Father?" Like, I'm carnal about situations. And I'm like, so you say something that could have some real truth, Jesus, but where's your Father? Like, bring him down to testify is basically what they're saying. Go get Joseph. Well, that's not his father. It's not his biological dad. But that's basically what they're trying to do, is they're going to go, "Well, that's not, we're not going to, we don't want to talk about spiritual matters. We want to get to the physical issue. You can't possibly be born of the Father in heaven. Bring Joseph down here." But the facts are that we would have known this was coming. Is that really the point of the story? I don't think so. I think the point is that it takes faith. But we need to be those that realize, well, do you have a problem with that? When you read that, do I have a problem with this? Jesus is saying, "I testify, I'm the Son of God." Because if you have a problem, if I have a problem, then that's where we stop. Right there. And begin to ask the Lord, like, "Who do I say your Son is?" Because I know a little bit about the Word, and I know that essentially when everything is all said and done, it matters very little about what good you did or what sins you committed. What matters is who Christ is. Who is he to you? Because there's not one person whose sins are too great for him to wash away and forgive. So when we're standing around contemplating who Jesus is, we're really saying we're messing with eternal salvation or eternal damnation. And that's where it's not something to just oh, I don't know. And that's where I think a lot of Christians get hung up. And that's where we find ourselves scratching our head later, is that the person of Jesus Christ, who is he? Well, he's the light of the world. There's no other light. There can be great people, but they're not the light of the world. There can be like gifted pastors, and there can be like amazing counselors and all these things, but they are not the light of the world. And they can be not even remotely a substitute for the presence of God, from the Holy Spirit, from revelation directly from Jesus Christ to your life, to my life, specifically. You can have counsel, and you can go to your brother and sister, and you can pray, and you can do a lot of really great things, but if Jesus is not the thing in which you're receiving, it is just a waste. So then when you go, you need Jesus, I need Jesus, we can lift each other up all day long, but it's not, oh, thank you, I feel so much better now that you all lifted me up. It's that we want to lift you up like those guys that lifted their buddy up, tore the roof off a house, and dropped him down. They didn't do it so that they could go, did you like how we lifted you up? Did you see how we tore the roof off that house? It was so that they could get him to Jesus. So that when he was with Jesus, then Jesus could forgive him of his sins and heal him of his ailments. It was Jesus. So the beauty of what Jesus is saying, he says this, you know what? He says, you know neither me nor my Father. If you knew me, you would know my Father also. These words he spoke. So then the other thing is, it goes on, it says, he taught in the temple and no one arrested him because his hour was not yet come, which that's another topic altogether, but it's the fact that Jesus had a predetermined time is the exact same for you and I. And when we start making all these, like, well, I don't want to talk to my mom, or I don't want to talk to my buddy, or I don't want to talk to him at work, or her at work, or I don't want to share Christ with them because we're afraid of that. Oh man, what's it going to do? And it's like, the reality is, it's going to do exactly what the Lord wanted it to do, and he has a predetermined hour for you. You don't need to fear how your life here on earth is going to work out, and how that's going to ruin it or do this to it, because Jesus himself here, he just goes on being obedient to his Father, and he should have by all means been literally captured right then. They could have called and had guys come out and grab him, and they could have brought him out to the mob outside, and they would have been happy to just wipe him out and stone him. But instead, what happens? The Holy Spirit is there calming the situation down and keeping it. And I think that's for us to know, like, in Christ, the Lord fills you with the Spirit. It's his Spirit. He gives you this desire to tell other people about it, and then there's this fear and this worry, and we should take his word as truth and go, I should not worry. Like, even there, like, that was so bold what you would do to the religious leaders right in their face. You told them they didn't know the Father in heaven. Like, that's crazy. Like, the magnitude of that is nuts. But we're like, I don't really want to tell them they need Christ in their life, or that Christ is the answer to their problem, or even I don't want to say, like, hey, want to just, like, go to church with me? Like, we're tripped out by that, and it's like, are you serious? Like, it's not that, it's like, man, you're so weak. It's just, the Lord wants to show you these things. When you step out in faith and do those things, he wants to reveal, look at how I held back that scenario. Look at what I did in it. It's not, oh, you're so weak and feeble, because we know Peter, he was, like, boastful, and then he goes out, and he's just, like, both feet in the mouth all the time, like, totally denies the Lord, but later the Lord comes to him. He knew all that, restores him, and then gives him a ministry that's amazing, that essentially the church today, a lot of the actual planting was Peter. So it's like, who am I? I'm nothing, but who is he? He's everything. And verse 21, it says, so he said to them again, I'm going away, and you will seek me, and you will die in your sin. Where I'm going, you cannot come. So the Jews said, will he kill himself, since he says, where I'm going, you cannot come? He said to them, you are from below, and I am from above. You are of this world, and I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. So they said to him, who are you? And Jesus said to them, just what I have been telling you from the beginning. I have much to say about you, and much to judge. But he who sent me is true, and I declare to the world what I have heard from him. They did not understand that he had been speaking to them about the Father. So Jesus said to them, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing on my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me. And he who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do the things that are pleasing to him. As he was saying these things, many believed in him. It seems like, this is the thing, like I can still remember reading through this stuff when I was in Bible college, and I don't know that if it's humbling, I don't even care, honestly. I was an idiot. I remember reading this stuff and loving Jesus, but thinking, what a bunch of idiots. Like, I thought, like, oh, dude, like, are they morons? Like, he keeps talking to him about his Father in heaven. They would have known that he's talking about that. Listen, this is literally, I'm here to do the will of the Father. I'm the Son. I'm God in the flesh. And they're still just scratching their heads. And I realized the older that I get that, man, I am so blessed that the Lord chose to reveal that truth to me. Because the fact is, and you guys all know this, you go about in your life, and to some, like, you are emanating the aroma of life. Like, they see something in you, it's Christ, and they're drawn to it, and it's good. But there are others that just automatically, you're bringing to them the aroma of death. They don't like anything about you. It's irritating that you would even walk the way you do in your self-righteous, like, perfect little manner, and they have all this anger towards you, and you're like... And it's this very thing that's being talked about right here. Jesus is saying, I am the way. Like, this is what you do, but you are going to die in your sins. And it's not Jesus' fault. It's theirs because of their hardness of heart. It's not that he didn't make it clear, because even just right here, he says it several times who he is. And they're saying, who is it? But it's those with hardened hearts. There's so many reasons why a person's heart is hardened. But most of it has to do with their own pride. It's just the fact that what Jesus is proclaiming, they don't want to deal with that. They've been living in such a religious way, and they've had it all work out for their benefit. This new covenant that Jesus is sharing, he's walking in, he's revealing that he's going to go to the cross. That he literally says, you won't even understand this until you lift the Son of Man, until he's crucified. You're not going to understand what's being said here. And so essentially, though, what is realistically happening is that whom he is drastically coming head on with the life they're living. And it would immediately devastate the course in which their life is already on in accordance to what they want it to be. Because that's the truth of anybody. Because when we're cruising down the road apart from Jesus... Doesn't matter if you're a Pharisee or if you're just like, I don't even have a clue. The minute that you come in contact with Jesus, it is a life completely altered. So these guys are sitting here and Jesus is saying the truth, and the truth is hitting. But to those that are just hardened to it and denying, they don't want that. I don't want that my life deterred from this course that it's on, that it's death. And I would just say that if any of us at any time, or like not just us, but even anybody that we know that we'd be able to just warn of this out of love, like lovingly warn and not just be like patting on the back when people are just denying that they need Christ, that they need salvation, that they need forgiveness of sins, that they need the Holy Spirit to reveal who Jesus is, that we would be those that are going, this man, Lord, I don't want that. I don't want that for anybody. And I don't want it to go down the road that leads me to this place where I'm so carnal that I just simply can't see that you are the Son of God. That the Father is pointing me to you. Everything I need is hidden. It's in you. It goes on, though, because Jesus, it says in verse, and we'll just cruise through this next section and then we'll pray. But it says in verse 31, which is beautiful because at the end there in 30, and I didn't talk about this, but how cool is it? There's all these people that are there that are just, but there are some that are there and they hear what Jesus says and they go, this is Jesus. Like they go, he's the Messiah. They come to believe in him from what he's saying, which is amazing. Many believed in him. But this is what's interesting in this next section is there's something to be said about, well, you believe, but what next? So verse 31 says, so Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Just that statement, if left alone, you'd be like, awesome, right? Like, you're going like, yeah, dude, like, they just got saved, and then he just is like, man, if you just abide, just stay connected to me. Like, we talked about it, it was like the first study I feel like we talk about abiding in the Lord, like being that branch that just gets all its nourishment from the trunk, from the vine, from Jesus, like having him be our substance in every way. So here we are, and Jesus makes that declaration to these that just came to believe in him. But what's interesting is that they're still wrestling with their old identity. They're still saying, where they're saying, well, I like you, Jesus, but here's who I am, because he begins to make a statement that they really don't love, because it says, you will know the truth, and he says, and it'll set you free. Verse 33 says, they answered him, we are offspring of Abraham, and you have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? And Jesus answered them, he said, truly, truly, which, little side note, like, you know, whenever it says truly, truly, that was the way that they would state a fact. So like, instead of saying truly and then say something, if you said a word twice, it was like documenting, like, this is the truth. So like, it'd be like going before a judge and having them swear you in. That's like when there's a word that's doubled up. I mean, that's the truth. So Jesus is like, okay, testify, truly, truly. It's like, here it is. This is the truth right here. Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who practices sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not remain in the house forever. The son remains forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are offspring of Abraham, yet you seek to kill me because my word finds no place in you. So Jesus' statement to these people that believe in him, if you're reading it the way I just read it, he's saying, listen, my word doesn't even find a place in you. That's, what are you talking about? Now, does that mean that none of these people begin to go, whoa, I need to understand what he's saying, and I believe that. I don't know. But I just know that in the mindset that he's correcting clearly, as he's saying this, they're declaring, well, whoa, we're not enslaved to anything. We're the children of Abraham. We're his promised people. How dare you say this to us? And he's simply saying, well, you're a slave to sin, because anybody that sins is a slave to sin. And so when he makes this statement to them, it's like, well, wait a second. And then he goes on to say, well, just as your father, Abraham, it says, I know that you're offspring of Abraham, so you seek to kill me because my word finds no place in you. You know what's interesting about Abraham, and I think here in the next couple of verses they kind of get after that, is that we know in Hebrews something about Abraham that these people should have known about Abraham, which was that Abraham was a man of faith, that he believed God. So these people here are trying to stake a claim to salvation and an inheritance by a birthright, by the flesh. See the thing that Jesus is trying to point out? You're trying to inherit the kingdom, which is spiritual, by a birthright in the flesh. It's no different than a person that's saying, when you go to them and you go, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and they go, oh, that's cool, but I'm a good person. I don't need forgiveness. They're trying to say, like, in another way, be like, oh, but that's cool, but I'm a child of Abraham. But we know that the law, what does the law do? It doesn't, there's no way. The law does not justify. It brings death. So when a person comes to us, when we think this way, well, it's not, it's, this is what I do, this is who I am, we're wrong. Because we know that in Hebrews, it was credited to Abraham by faith. So we know, well, even Jesus saw Abraham, because Jesus, or Abraham, looked forward by faith, Hebrews tells us, and saw that which was promised. Did he actually receive it? No, but by faith he saw it. It's in Hebrews recorded for us to read, to be encouraged, that what Jesus is saying here is true. It's awesome. But it goes on. It says in verse 38, it says, I speak of what I have seen with my father, and you do what you have heard from your father. Your father. Let's keep going. It says, they answered him, Abraham is our father. And Jesus said to them, if you were Abraham's children, you would be doing the works Abraham did. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. This is not what Abraham did. You are doing the works that your father did. And they said to him, we were not born of sexual immorality. We have one father, even God. And Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me, for I came from God and am here, not of my own accord, but he who sent me. Why do you not understand what I say? It's because you cannot bear to hear my word. You are of your father the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. What? Like, I sat in my room and I read it. Like I said, it's, so here, the setting, Jesus proclaims who he is. People believe it. Then he says, here's who I am. And they go, and he says, listen, I'm the truth. It'll set you free. And then they go, what? Free from what? We're not in bondage. And then he talks about sin and they, well, we're children of Abraham. So he starts to go down. Well, you know, you're not. You're children of your father, which he's referencing the devil. And so then they're like, well, we weren't conceived in immorality. So they're basically trying to, again, justify. What are you talking about? There's no sin in us. It's the same thing that we do when we try to justify ourselves. What are you talking about? And so Jesus is going down the line and nailing it out hard to these people that just said, I believe. This is something for me, and I'm praying through this because I feel like the Lord has given me something not to condemn, but for me to realize, okay, if somebody comes to me and they've never heard, they've never been shown God's word, they've never heard of creation, they never knew about sin, but they just simply come to me and they are starting to understand that something's wrong with them. They're like, there's something inside of them that every time they try to do the things that are good, they can't, and they find what we all know as Christians to be sin, and that it's your flesh. So then what maybe is an issue that we handle wrong is that we immediately want to get them to Jesus for salvation, but not ever even letting them know who Jesus is. We just simply are like, you're going to hell, you need to go to heaven, all you need to do is say this saying. And I remember a couple years ago that I heard a pastor talking about how that he was sitting at home and he was literally like watching the Tom and Jerry, and he saw the devil on one side and the angel on the other, and then it made him think that he was like, wow, if I died now, I'm pretty bad. I'd go to hell, I think. So he went down to a church and just went in and said, hey, you know, what's this whole deal about heaven and hell? And the pastor there basically began to say, yeah, man, if you believe in Jesus, then you don't even need to worry about the hell side of thing. So essentially, like, all you need is Jesus. So then the guy goes, well, what do I need to do? And he goes, well, man, you just need to repeat after me. And he said the sinner's prayer with the guy, and the guy was like, okay. So that's it? And he's like, yeah, man, that's it. And then he went home and he, nothing. Nothing. No change. And his story goes on as he goes to tell more, but the point of it is, that's kind of where we've dropped the ball majorly, because when you read the New Testament and you see all of this stuff, even the Gentiles would have known about the religion of the Jews. They would have known about sin. They would have known. So when they come in to preach the good news of the gospel, it's that there's no longer a need for you to make sacrifice. But what is it that there is always kind of implied that we would understand? Sin. So when he's here telling him, I am the Son of God, the light of the world, I am the truth, that they go, well, okay, yeah, I'll take that. I'll take the salvation. But then when it's like, well, here's the deal, you're in sin. It's like, whoa, what are you trying to do? I don't want that. I just like the salvation side of you, Jesus. I like that identity thing. I don't really want to be dealing with what I was doing or like, and that's the harshest thing. It's for me, it's like, man, I need to spend more time. If someone comes to me and is starting to share those truths, that I want to educate them and almost go all the way back to Genesis and legitimately give them the rundown. Does it mean that we all need to be scholars? No, but if you spend time with Jesus and you know, and you ask the questions you ought to ask, what are these doctrines? What did the church in Acts do? They continued daily in what? In the apostles' doctrines and the fellowship and the breaking of bread. Why? Because that's what the Lord had desired for them to do. Why? Equip them, fill them, be part of their lives, show them who they are, get them to understand sin, get them to understand the other side, which is who they are in Christ and their true identity and all the riches that are in Christ. So being able to say, whoa, hold up, man. You know what's going on in your life? You're dealing with, literally, you're starting to understand. You may not get it here, but you're starting to feel what's going on, and the Holy Spirit is probably drawing you in. But you need to understand about what's happening in you. And yeah, you share what, like the fall of man in the garden. like how the sin entered the world, how everyone is born in sin, and how it automatically that's what we go after. And it sounds simple, right? Everybody in this room probably, oh, I got that, I know that. But it's so weird that somehow, in the end, we start telling people, well, you, yeah, man, just say Romans 10, 9, and 10. Just make this confession, and then you're saved. And it's like, but Jesus is here, and he essentially has these people say, I believe in you. And then he's like just hammering them. It's like, what? He's just like, dude, you're from your father, the devil. And they're just like, I just got saved, man. What do you do? And it's like, yeah, dude, deal with it. What are you going to do with it? Because I came to set you free. I don't want you hanging out with Satan. I don't want you going to your daddy every day that you're born into this. And I'm telling you, I came to set you free. And you don't even believe you're in handcuffs. You're like sitting in the prison cell going poop and pee all over yourself going, oh, I just love to be a Christian. And I came to break the chains and take the captives free so you could be in the light. And so the reality is Jesus, he handles it. So when we sit down with someone who's saying, oh, my life is messed up, the answer is the light, the truth of Jesus Christ. And the fact is that half the time, myself included, that it's easier for us to just be like, well, let me pray for you, or man, I don't know. Like these situations, it's like, wait a second. Half the time, these people, when you sit there and actually contemplate, they'll get to a place of being like, well, I'm of Abraham. What are you talking about? And you go, wait, hold up. Because I had that happen like 10 days ago. I got a phone call. Actually, I made the phone call, and I'm talking to people, to a person that some in this room know, and we're having this talk. This guy should have known Jesus. I spent years with this guy telling me, going to church, reading his Bible, you know Jesus, you know. We start talking and he starts asking some questions and he's broken now. Some stuff has went down. He's at the pit. And you know what the reality was? He did not know Jesus. He had never actually accepted that forgiveness of sin and confessed it. Not saying that you go, because it was amazing how the Holy Spirit grabbed a hold of him. He literally asked me, do I need to go somewhere and go write out all the sins I've ever done? This is someone I've known for years that has gone to Athey Creek, have read and been there, and it's like the brokenness hit him so hard that he was just like, what do I do? What do I need to do? Do I just need to tell you everything I ever did? And I said, no, because the reality is, what you're feeling right now is the actual Holy Spirit saying, I came to set you free. So you're feeling like, I just want to let go of all of it. Yeah, because the chains are coming off, because you're starting to receive forgiveness and a new identity, because now you understand what you never understood before. You need a Savior, because it's out of control. You can't do it. Like the flesh, Abraham, the sacrifice, the try to do good, then to make the sacrifice and be in God's graces, fall back every single year, come back, make sacrifice, blood offering, covering, every single year coming back. It's just a burden. And Jesus Christ comes in and he says, listen, I have come to smash those chains and destroy it and crush the head of Satan, but you cannot be in his household. And that's the reality. So it's like when he blasts these people, and it says in verse 43, why do you not understand what I say? It's because you cannot bear to hear my word. Because the word of God, it convicts. It is hardcore. But to the person that says yes, it's everything. The life you now have is so amazing. It's not perfect. It's hard. But it's full. And you're not alone. You'll just like Jesus says, I'm never alone. Neither am I. Neither are you if Christ is your Lord. If you've come to him with that understanding and received it, and you're not trying to live in your old identity. You're not saying, well, wait a second. You can't tell me this because I'm this. No. Abraham was a sinner. But because he believed God and was faithful and by faith trusted him, it was given to him. So it's by faith, even in the Old Testament. That's what's so amazing, is the Lord saying, look, I'm tying this all together for you because I'm the same. Yesterday, Genesis 1:1. Today, here in your midst, light of the world, truth in front of you, forever in eternity, ruling and reigning. So when we get to that place and he's saying, look, it might be hard right now because I'm going to literally expose sin, because I'm going to bring it out into the light and shine the light on it. But if you would receive it and identify and say, yes, Lord, it's sin, Lord, then you come to a place of going, I'm so sinful, I'm so messed up, I'm so dirty. Then the Lord goes, yes. And that's why I shed my blood on the cross, is to wash away all of that sin, to forgive you of it once and for all, that you can be with me in the light, stay with me in the light. You're going to struggle, but run to the light. Don't run away. Run to the light and be with Jesus. So when he states these hardcore things, it's for our benefit. Let's finish it out. There's just a few more verses as he continues to give him a little more combination punches. Verse 44, he says, you are of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. He lies. He speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. But because I tell the truth, you do not believe me. Which one of you convicts me of sin? If I tell the truth, why do you not believe me? Whoever is of God hears these words of God. The reason why you do not hear them is that you are not of God. So it sounds like a really crazy place to end a Bible study. The end. But it's exactly where I want to end it. And you can read the rest of the chapter, and it's great, because he goes into the next section is where he talks about before Abraham was, I am, and how that he even reveals this, and this is who I am, this is who Abraham is, and it's more of a lighthearted thing. But why stop there? I don't know. I prayed about it. That's where we end. So here's the deal. Until we are in a place where we could go down this line and say, look, man, like, if I turn away from Jesus and live in my flesh, this is who I'm serving. The father of lies, a murderer. There's no truth in him. Then I have to make, because that's the thing, is like, for all of us, and I'm just laying it out there. So, I mean, you can go away, and if it's true of you and you want to deny it, then horrible. But if it's true of you, then the beautiful thing about Jesus is that he lays the truth out, because he wants for you to see, look, you know who owns the deed to your life right now? It's not you. The world is standing in this midst with Satan ruling over them, thinking, look at me now. I am ruling and reigning in my life. And if they could see the truth, they would see how in bondage that they are, and a servant of sin and ensnared, and they have no freedom. And the Lord is standing there, and he's saying, this is what is really happening, and he exposes it. You're ensnared, enslaved, serving the Father, the Prince of this world. Why? Because there's a better way. So is that word for us? Yeah, totally. And then the thing is, where do we apply that when we go to work? Because I don't believe that you go into it hammering and smashing and trying to go, man, you're filthy, rotten sinner. But you go into it being so thankful. Because just first to be called into the household of God, to be washed, to be forgiven, is to receive so much grace and mercy. So when we're out there with people that don't know our Lord, and we realize, yeah, I want to reveal the truth like Jesus did here, but it's always done out of love. It's always done out of grace and mercy. But the fact is that if we're not actively seeking to share that truth, and if we're not actively seeking to walk in the light with Jesus and don't look at him as the truth, then everything we're doing is a lie. And the reason why we don't have fruit in our lives is because we've gone back to our old ways, but yet we love the idea of salvation. I don't want to be a person who has a life that's just totally for myself, but oh, safety switch, I've got Jesus. At the end, I go to heaven, but now I live for me. I want to be a person that as I'm living here, I'm with Christ, whatever that means. So if today I get to, by the grace of God, share truth and get to be part of seeing a brother or sister come to know Christ, praise the Lord, that's the greatest thing that you can experience. It's like, that's it. I'm ready, Lord. That's the most amazing. It's from death to life. Hallelujah. But if it's so that I can go outside and just dig in the mud because I got a vehicle stuck, or I'm like picking up dog turds or whatever it is, the reality is I go, but I'm not a slave to sin. Like, I'm free. And the fact is while I'm out there, there's so much for me to learn about how the Lord does all these things in my life. So the point is everything that we get to do in Christ, there's so much to be thankful for. So when we go to share that love with people, and like we all talk about during Christmas, it's a perfect opportunity because people make it an opportunity. They start to say, oh, what do you guys do for Christmas? Oh, how do you celebrate? Oh, and the thing is, it's whatever that you can do in Christ. If you do everything heartily is unto the Lord, but don't do it unto man, then you'll find maybe for you, you'll say, well, I'll probably go to like a Christmas Eve service or something. Do you want to go? Or you can be like, yeah, you know what? It's not about Santa. And maybe you share the gospel. I don't know. But the reality is that it's all about us going, this is who I am. This whole season, it's not a season. It's a life. But it's cool that right now we can go out of here and we can just thank the Lord that we're forgiven. Like the woman that was caught in adultery, that you can go out of here and the Lord just gives us one word. He says, all this I've done. All the accusers are out of here. Why? Because I've done away with them. Just you go and sin no more. But Lord, I'm not perfect. No, because that's why I shed my blood. But I'm with you everywhere you go. Yeah, let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much that your word is everything that we need. It's pretty sad, Lord, when we look around and just see so many people that don't have hope. The illusion of this world and what Satan has done, lulling so many people, they're just so blind and so caught up in snares, Lord. It's horrible. Lord, I just pray that even just within this small group of us tonight, Lord, that you would just find a place, that we would read your word and receive it with gladness. And Lord, sometimes it is a hard word depending on where we've been, but it's the truth. And Lord, everything about you is love. Everything you've done is for us. Help us, Lord, to realize that. And I pray that we wouldn't try to just pick and choose the things of your word or the different attributes of who you are. But I pray that each of us, just tonight and tomorrow and the days that follow, would seek to know you, all of you, every bit of you, who you are, what you're doing. I pray that when we open up your word tomorrow morning, that we wouldn't do it the way we did before, but what we would do is we'd open it knowing that it's you. The word became flesh. It's your very word that we hold in our hands tonight, and it's so full of love from you and truth. It's exactly what we need, and I pray that we would extend that love to those around us, and I pray specifically just even for this Christmas season, Lord, there are more people that are hurting. There are more people that are guarded this time of year than ever, and I pray that, Lord, by your Holy Spirit, because that's the only way that you would use us, that, Lord, even if just one gets to hear and from that begins to believe or comes to know you or is watered or encouraged, then let it be, Lord. And I pray that it would be all to the glory of you and your Son. And, Lord, I just thank you. I thank you even just for the fact that we have the freedom to come together and meet. Lord, that we're not in a place that it's illegal. As many of our brothers and sisters literally cannot meet in a house. They can't meet there more than once, and if they meet, they might have their lives taken. We don't know what that's like. So we pray for those that are in hard places like that, that are seeking you and sharing your word and literally facing death because of who you are, and they know. They know that you are the Son of God. They know, Lord, that you are the Messiah. So, Lord, fill us with that same spirit. Empower your church. So we thank you for meeting with us tonight. We pray that you would just bless the rest of our time hanging out. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So last thing, the blankets that we got. I don't know if you guys, I think everybody knows about it. But we were able to get, I think we have like 25 to 30 blankets. And they're all out in Amazon smiling boxes in my garage. And the hope is to try to go down this week, that we're coming into, really all that I was thinking that we would do is just get a group of us, whoever can do it. I'm thinking probably like Thursday at some point, but I'll send out a text or email or however we contact all of you guys. But essentially my hope is to just go downtown and essentially just go down like Burnside and find some of the various little pockets and basically just go give blankets, let the Lord lead. It could potentially be amazing and awesome, or it could just be, here's all our blankets are gone. But the point is that we're just answering what I believe that the Lord had just called us all to do, which is just to reach out to those that are in need. So however that need is met and however it goes down is awesome. But any of you guys are welcome. Even if it comes down to us having one blanket a person, that's awesome. If it turns out that it's two of us, that's awesome. There's no, if you're busy and your week is crazy, it's all good. Don't feel like you're a loser. You probably already are. No, just kidding. but we'll definitely, I think it'll be cool. I believe that something exciting will happen. So, but that's it. And I guess we can release the hounds to come tear us up, all the kids. And I think my wife might have beaten them because I heard screams.